Hello there, welcome back, thanks for being here. So in our last lecture, we have created a stub programmatically. We have loaded WireMock JRE8 Maven dependency into our pom.xml. So after which we were successfully able to get all the WireMock related class files into our project. And we have created a stub and we have also tested that through REST Assured. In this video, I'm gonna explain you the similar thing, but I'm going to have a little extended learning. So in previous stuff, if you have looked into that, we have hard coded the response. So I have just printed a basic string on the console. But if you work in real time, you tend to have a complex JSON messages, where you have a nested JSONs, array of JSON messages as a response that would be coming in. And also there would be a need that you should keep your response file separately in a specific folder and read them and then print the response or do whatever the validation that we would like to do. So the same concept was also covered in one of our previous WireMock lecture when we were testing manually through Postman. I have clearly stated that we have to keep those files under a directory called underscore underscore files within the WireMock. So when you start a WireMock server, what happens, there would be two folders which would be generated automatically. One is mappings and another one is underscore underscore files. So mapping is the directory where your mappings would reside, contracts, and files is the place where you keep your response related files. If you wanted to read some response dynamically, you keep the files and you read as and when you want. So in this learning, we are going to do exactly the same, but this time we will do programmatically, like we'll see how that can be achieved through automation. Yeah, so without a delay, let me start creating a class and write a stub. So if in order to set the stage for you all, so in this learning I'm gonna create a get mapping. So the method that I'm going to operate is get, and I'll have some context URL given, and when I get that, I should see a status code of 200. And also I should see a JSON message. So that will have a list of players that we've already seen that. Okay. So the documentation says, this is the getting started page. We have already looked at it. This is a Maven dependency. And then we should also have some static import statement. I've explained why we need to import statically, because all the methods like stub for get, post, and URL equals to will return, these are all static methods in the WireMock client class. So that is the reason we have to do a static import so that all those methods are listed. Okay, so we have a significant difference between static methods and the normal instance methods. So where instant methods, like you need to create an object and to with the help of object reference you can call, and but wherein the static methods you can call with the help of a class name. So if you have a static import, you can even call them directly with their name. So in order to have them loaded into our class without any hassle, so we are going to have the static import. So there we go. So let me I have created a class which is get mapping. So that is where we are in exactly right now. So this particular get mapping, I would add a method, so which is public void get stub. So I would create this method. So we have had a static import of all it already. So stub for, let me just write a method, stub for. So it actually takes a parameter which is mapping builder, and as I told, let us work with get request in this particular lecture. So get, and I would say URL is version 1 and players, this is my URL, context URL or endpoint you can also say, and this endpoint, let me just hit enter, will return. Will return actually takes a response definition builder. So I have explained to you that there is a method called a response. So a response with a status code, say I would like to have 200 as a status code, and there comes our change with body. So earlier we have just used the, there are so many overloaded methods. You can see body as a byte, body as a string, body as a file name, body as a base64 string, body as a JSON body. So there are so many overloaded methods are there. So last time we have worked with body as a string. This time let us work with body file. Yeah. So the body file name, we have to specify the file from which we are actually reading the particular response. So I have a file which is already copied into the directory, which is __files. This is where my WireMock instance. And if I navigate to the files directory, you can see a file called employee. If I just open this file, you have a JSON message that has you have an array of JSON messages that has three messages, like each has three fields: ID, name, and department. So this is the response I would like to be served when I hit that particular endpoint. That's what the agenda. So we already know that WireMock expects a file to be present in that particular files directory. You need not give the absolute path. So as far as you specifying the file name, it's all enough. So WireMock can find recognize that. And also I wanted to set that with header, I will say basically content type. I wanted to set this as application/json. application/json would be my content type, and I think that's it. So I don't think any other parameters are required at this point in time. Let us just keep it very simple. So the understanding here is that when somebody reaches the context URL v1/players with the help of a get method, so it will return a status code of 200, and it will return the content whatever present in that particular file employee.json, and the content type would be application/json. So this is the very simple stuff, and let us write a test for it. So it is essential that we need to test this particular stuff. So creation of stub is a part and parcel of our QA job. So once you are done with writing the stub, so it is your responsibility to test it. So I would say public void test one method, and let me import this. I wanted to run it as a JUnit test. Let me write rest assured piece of snippet here. Rest assured dot base URI. This is the URI or URL. So since it is running in my local http://localhost, and we know that it is running in 8080 port. Yeah. And now we have set up the URL, and then rest assured dot given. Okay, I think I have done a mistake. So rest assured dot given, and I wanted to print all the log messages, so I will log all when, sorry, it's not wait, when. So basically this is a BDD syntax, just for your understanding. So this will actually help you to write the test cases far better. So that is the reason, if you look at any of the rest assured script, they are quite readable because of this given when then BDD syntax, behavior driven model. So I think from the structure, from the snippet, it is one can easily understand that okay, when I have the facilitation of logging all the messages, and when I just call this method get, and what is the endpoint that we are trying to reach, /v1/players, that's what the endpoint. And I think this is done, so we will just close this method, and let me just read the response. So from the response, so initially let us put some validations, or let us just print the status code, response dot get status code. So I would like to read this status code, which is an int value, and then sys out, or maybe you can just also have assert that. So status code is 200, and let me just check. I think I need to import. Yeah, so I think I need to just do a import statement. I think the method got deprecated, so that is the reason. So let us use another thing, assert. Okay, so let us just verify for now. Let me just print the status code for now, and also let me print some response just to make sure that we are able to see that file response successfully. So what I'm doing, guys, so initially I created a stub and I said that this is going to be a get method and this is the context URL. And this will return the status code 200 and the content type is this, and the response is going to be returned from this file employee.json, which is there in our files directory. And also let us just check response dot content type maybe content equals this is application slash JSON. Okay, let us put validations. So now we have had a registration script for testing the stub and we have created a stub, but we are not actually calling the stub. So earlier in my lecture you have seen me calling this stub right at the test method, but let us do some little tweak in this lecture. So I wanted to do this as an industry framework practice. So I will have a method called public void setup. So this is basically a setup tier up method. So in this particular method, I would start my wire mock or my get mapping get stub. So ideally what happens is that JUnit has set of annotations like which is before, at, and after. So before the at test is executed, the code that is present in the before annotation is executed. So the execution starts from here. So it knows that it has to start this particular stub. So once it writes the stub, then the attest would be executed and we can find test this one. So let me just run this as a JUnit test and let me click OK. Test case has started and you see the response got printed, and let me go to the console. So you have seen that this is the endpoint that we have invoked and this is the get method, and the body that we have printed was this one. So that's it, guys. So this simple it is just to read the response from another file. This would be the practice when you are working with any other microservice model related APIs wherein you wanted to read. And you can also just see whether the status code is 200 or not. Just do a sysout and 200. So the validation also got passed. That is the reason you can see the content type content was equal to application slash JSON. So you see now the content, now status code is 200. Okay. So that's it for this video, guys. So in the upcoming lecture, I would like to introduce a new thing called how do we even eradicate the manual effort in this thing. So far we are starting the standalone server, but moving forward we will completely manage the server actions also through program. We have a concept called JUnit rule. Through JUnit rule we will start the server in different ports and then we execute server starting and also the stub creation and all that. So that is going to be a zero touch automation, so no need of manual effort at all. So stay focused, guys. I think this is something which is essential for you guys to understand how to read the response from the external file. So I hope you have learned something new here and you have liked this video. So please do subscribe to this channel so that whenever I push a video, you guys are aware that there is something new for you to learn. So thank you so much, guys. You have a great rest of today.